I'm going to describe how a quantum state evolves during weak measurement. The problem has two aspects. One is a theoretical one, and the other one is experimental one. The theory part, I already gave a lecture during the school, and so I will go through it at lightning speed. Time is limited, and no questions. My focus will be on the experimental part and describe how well it agrees with the theory. The theory is a built-up version of what Nicolas Gisin did more than 30 years ago. The experimental data is coming from Vijay Raghavan's lab in TIFR Mumbai. So let me start. The standard textbook quantum mechanics gives two rules for evolution of a state: Schrodinger evolution, unitary, continuous, reversible, and deterministic. A projective measurement description of von Neumann, discontinuous and irreversible and probabilistic, but still it takes pure state to pure state and consistent on repetition. The problem that we need to understand is fill in the gap of what happens in a particular experimental run. Can we construct a description of the theory instead of just having an ensemble interpretation? And for that purpose, I'm going to construct an interpolation of this bond rule prescription, which say takes rho goes to pi, rho pi, pi are the projection operator. To construct the interpolation, I'm going to take help of the paradigm of weak measurement, where the system and the apparatus are very weakly coupled, which stretches out the time scale over which the measurement takes place. And even with that stretched out time scale, I assume that the system and the apparatus are shielded completely from the environment. So the rest of the environment doesn't enter the picture at all. It raises new questions about how to do the interpolation and what kind of properties should be maintained, how will things change if there are multipartite measurements, et cetera, et cetera. And that requires replacing these projective measurement axioms by different continuous and stochastic dynamics. This in the literature has also sometimes been called unraveling of quantum collapse. What it does is constructs a set of quantum trajectories interpolating between the initial and the final state, and in between there can be a combination of deterministic evolution and some noise. There are strong constraints on this interpolation. One is the measurement has to be repeatable, which means the eigenstates have to be fixed points of the evolution. That makes the evolution necessarily nonlinear. And the other part is that the description should not conflict with special relativity, which does not have any concept of simultaneity. So if there are multipartite measurements and they do not conflict with the quantum results, the bond rule has to come out as a constant of evolution during the measurement. It does not change as a function of time. And such a description exists, and that is what Gisin constructed in 1984. The important features of this description are that it combines noise and a deterministic evolution together with a constraint that the fluctuation dissipation relation is obeyed. And essentially, the fluctuation dissipation theorem becomes equivalent to bond rule. It's a new connection, an unusual one. The other part is that the dynamics is completely local between the system and the apparatus, does not involve the environment at all. And these features point towards the important consequence that whatever is happening is between the system and the apparatus. The dissipation means going towards the eigenstate is certainly dictated by the apparatus and the observable you are measuring. And if the fluctuation is tied to that, then the fluctuation also has to come from the same process. It cannot come from a different process coupling to the environment, so you can forget about other things like gravity or cosmic microwave background radiations. They are not involved. And pictorially, it can be depicted by something like this. A state starting going either to one eigenstate or other one. The evolution is taking on a surface of a unit sphere, maintains the norm. And finally, the measurement can be considered as an effective process of some fundamental theory which produces these trajectories. The equation has a very simple structure. There is a geodesic part, which is nothing but the great circle on that unit sphere going from the initial state to the eigenstate. And this is the differential equation which generates the geodesic. It has various built-in properties. It preserves rho square equal to rho. Projective measurements are the fixed point of the evolution. The equation is linear in the projection operator, so environment just decouples because sum over pi equal to 1. And if I do a reduced trace over the environment, those degrees of freedom don't appear in the system at all. And these properties are actually related to a picture which inverts the role of the system and the apparatus. For pure state, P is a projection operator. Rho is also a projection operator. And what this equation does is actually it decoheres the pointer state of the apparatus by the Lindblad formulation. There is no inconsistency in that. And there is a back reaction which produces a negative sign which says how the system will change in an opposite manner. When you add multiple fixed points, this is the same operators, and I'm combining them with some weights. So it's a sum over all possible evolutions toward different fixed points. And wi are some weights. They are normalized by convention to be add up to 1. And g is an overall proportionality constant, which dictates how quickly I go to the eigenstate. And the equation also has some nice properties that if I determine the devolution of the diagonal elements, the off-diagonal ones are completely known. And in that manner, it actually has only n minus 1 diagonal degrees of freedom, even though the equation is written in the language of the density matrix with n squared terms. This equation, if I put this wi as to some fixed numbers, that does not do the correct job. And it basically, with an instantaneous value for the bond rule, if I use that at wi, it will just go to the closest fixed point and does not give a probabilistic distribution over all fixed points. And to get rid of that, I have to add some noise to the geodesic while still retaining the various properties. It's interesting that the various properties that I mentioned hold irrespective of what value of wi I choose. And so I can add various kind of noise. The consequences, if the weights are fixed according to this instantaneous bond rule, I go to the closest fixed point. If I make the weights completely random, I get a democratic distribution. It goes to all the fixed points with equal probability. And for some intermediate value of the noise, I go to the various fixed points according to the bond rule. And to give the answer, it is easy to write down the equation for just one qubit, which is easy to solve in the sense that there are analytic solutions you can construct explicitly and see all the properties verified. And in that case, there is only one degree of freedom. So all this complicated equation collapsed to only one equation that I have to solve. There I can put in two terms. One is this bond term, which is a weights equal to the projection of the density matrix on that particular eigenstate, and then there is a noise, and the square root of S, which is the spectral density of noise, gives a proportionality or relative weights of how much is the geodesic term and how much is the noise. And this is becomes a stochastic process of the interval 0 to 1 for 1 qubit, and the boundary points are perfectly absorbing. So if you go to the boundary points, which are eigenstates, there is no more evolution. The numerical results can be easily obtained, and it looks like this. You start somewhere in the middle, it fluctuates. Sometimes you end up on one side, sometimes you end up on the other side. And the equation can be converted from that Langevin equation form, which I wrote earlier, to the Ito form, which is numerically easy to handle by using the usual stochastic dynamics. And it has two terms, one proportional to dt for time evolution, and another is proportional to dw, which is the Wiener noise. The square is equal to dt. And this equation obeys bond rule, which is the expectation value of this d rho rho equal to 0 when the coefficient of dt vanishes. And that is the constraint that d times s equal to 1. And this is the constraint which Dissan used in his description of the process. And in that case, bond rule is the constant of evolution. You can solve the equation of exactly and see what the description is. And after that, you can convert that Langevin process to a Fokker-Planck equation. And that also is a very easy solution. It is a sum of two Gaussians in a coordinate system where you change that 0 to 1 interval to minus infinity to infinity. And these are the two Gaussians. They behave like solitons. The area under each of the peak is fixed. They don't interact. One area gives the probability of going to one fixed point. The other area gives the probability to go to the other fixed point. And the width of the Gaussian and the velocity of the two Gaussian peaks is identical. And this is a theoretical description of the trajectories. And the point is to check whether this agrees with the experiment or not. The interesting point is this whole description has only one parameter, which is the strength of the coupling G between the system and the apparatus. Everything else is fixed. And if you want the little more generalization, the coupling can be made time dependent. And wherever is GT becomes integral G times DT. That is because the bond rule is a constant of evolution and time can be just reparametrized. So now let me go to the experimental setup and show you the result. The experiments were done on a 3D transmon qubits, dispersively coupled to a microwave cavity. Vijay Raghavan gave a talk here a couple of days back. And it gives a signal which is amplified with a phase-sensitive amplifier running very close to the quantum limit. And weak measurements result when the probe magnitude of this amplifier is very small and the two Gaussians overlap. And this is a kind of analog of the Stern-Gerlach measurement. In this case, there are two peaks, but the two peaks are very highly overlapping. The width is much larger than the separation between the two peaks, the order of magnitude for this particular run. And then you can construct from the observed signal the density matrix by using the Bayesian formulation, and which basically gives a quantum trajectory one by one, and you can do verification on those trajectories using the quantum state tomography. I should mention that this is a diffusion process which goes back and forth and which is different than spontaneous collapse, which is monotonic. And the diffusion basically takes place along the meridian of the Bloch sphere. And I basically run out of the time, so let me show you the experimental data and the theoretical fit, and this is the result. So the red points are the experimental data constructed from an ensemble of 4 lakh trajectories, and the blue curves is a theoretical fit with only one parameter, which is the system apparatus coupling. There are 100 points in this interval 0 to 1. The chi-square is about 17 to 27, running over various evolution times of the trajectory. It's an excellent description of the whole system in terms of only one parameter, and there's a small variation on G, which is because of the uncertainty or the inefficiency of the detector system. So that basically gives a solution to the problem of what happens during a measurement. It's a dynamics of quantum diffusion. And the problem of bond rule has been separated out into a apparatus-dependent noise. The important point is that the bond rule answers depend on the system. The noise is independent of the system. And if you understand what this noise is coming from, it will probably give an understanding of what is the underlying theory. But what is certain is that to understand bond rule, you do not need any fancy interaction other than this quantum diffusion process and the fluctuation-dissipation relation, which relates d rho square, which is the fluctuation, the geodesic movement along the towards the fixed point. And that's as much as I can say. More details later for whoever is interested. I'm willing to describe. Thank you very much.
Thanks to Professor Patel for such a nice talk.